Well, I got a bunch of notes, but I'm not gonna get it. Since I'm gonna do this again next Wednesday, I'm gonna split this up in two lessons for that brother George. Just give you a little bit of the night and rest up next week.
He can quit by 15:08, so
we'll see how it goes. Okay, we're gonna read in 1 Timothy chapter 6. We're gonna read, I guess, my first 8 verses and see how far we get from there, and then we'll go from there and try to get this whole chapter done tonight and next week. There's a lot of stuff in this chapter. I'm gonna stay 2 weeks on this, so. And this deal, what I'll call, just gonna touch the surface. But we're gonna read the first 8 verses and then we'll make a few comments. That's our go home, I know we all are. 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy 6, 1. Am I talking too fast?
A little louder.
About to bust my ear, but I turn my ear in. You got this thing turned up?
As much as it's got.
Okay. I'll get right up here again. Oh, I can't do that. Be a little uncomfortable. Okay, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 1. Let as many servants as are under the yoke count their own masters worthy of all honor, that the name of God and his doctrine be not blasphemed. Excuse me. And they that have believing masters, let them not despise them because they are brethren, but rather do them service because they are faithful and beloved, takers of the benefit. These things teach and exhort. If any man teach otherwise, and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strife of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings, perverted disputes of men of corrupt minds, and destitute of the truth, supposing to gain his godliness from such withdraw thyself. But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. We'll stop right there, and if we get that far, we need to go on over the world. President. Anyway, politician here, Timothy, the young pastor, in his first 2 verses, he's teaching in the duty of servants, instructing in the duty of service and master. A servant, a definition for servant, is a person devoted to any service, to a cause, or to another. A person devoted to any service, cause, or to another. And that word devoted means to be dedicated, very loyal, faithful. And I think a lot of God's people need to ask themselves a question. Am I truly devoted to God as a servant? There's a lot of God's people that only serve out of convenience. And I think for them to be honest with themselves, they'll probably do better as servants. But a servant is a person devoted any service. So being devoted or dedicated, very loyal or faithful takes a lot of self-sacrifice to do this, to do it like God would have us to do it. Verse 1, those that are under the yoke or the authority are to count their master worthy of all honor. Kind of his master worthy of all honor. Need to do that in the name of God and his doctrine, not be blasphemed. We should serve God in a way, in a manner that would glorify him, that we do nothing whatsoever that cause his name to be defamed, slandered, or spoken of contemptuously by worldly men. We need to walk a pretty tight road, you know, to honor God and everything that we do. It's so easy to get off just a little bit, and we get busy in our worldly duties, whatever we might be doing. Not just flat out dishonoring, but just kind of slack up on it. I wish it'd be as Paul said in Philippians chapter 1, verse 20, be ashamed in nothing, but with all boldness, magnify Christ in our bodies, whether it be by life or by death, whatever, to honor God, serve and honor God. The servant should respect his master, reverence God and his word. And I don't know, but it seems like the way the world's getting, the churches, the way these churches are doing, getting out in left field, they're dishonoring God. Not really showing a reverence for God and his word. That's something that the servant should do, is have respect for God and reverence for his work, his word. The servant should be obedient, loyal to duty. I'm going to turn to Titus chapter 2, verse 9 and 10 there. It says, exhort servants, this is Paul, right to Timothy. It's Paul right here. Exhort servants to be obedient to your own master and to please him well in all things. Not answering again, or back talking, not prolonging, but showing all good fidelity, that they may grow in the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. Exhorting servants to be obedient to their own master, please him well in all things. That's what the servant should do, be loyal to his master. Should be faithful. We're told in Colossians chapter 3, verse 22, obey in all things. Serve him wholeheartedly, not just half-hearted. I had some people working under my supervision when I was in trouble. Before getting them to do anything, he had to push. And the servant of God does not need to do things this way. You need to be faithful and obey and do whatever needs to be done. Colossians chapter 3, verse 22. Verse 24, we're going to read there. It says, servants, obey all things, in all things your master, according to his flesh, not with thy service, as men pleasure, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. Whatsoever ye do it heartily, as to the Lord and not unto men. Lord, that of the Lord you shall receive the reward of the inheritance where you serve the Lord Christ. Obey in all things, and not serve to please men, please God. Be faithful. Serve wholehearted, not just enough to get by. We'll be rewarded for what we do to the Lord. We need to do all we can in serving him. Be patient. Go to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 16 through 20. There will be hard times, and we know that there will be hard times. We're not promised a bed of roses that because we're saved and child of God. There's going to be hard times. So we need to count it a privilege to serve the Lord. Verse 19 of that passage there, it said, it's thankworthy of God we, believers or servants, suffer while serving him. It's thankworthy that we suffer for Christ. As servants of God, we're commanded to be patient toward all men. We find this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 14. And render good for evil, verse 15 of that same chapter. compassion toward all men. Told in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24, the servant of the Lord does not strive or argue. Verse 24, 2 Timothy chapter 2, when the servant of the Lord does not strive, but be gentle toward all men, after teaching, compassion. Romans chapter 12 recompense no man to no man evil for evil, for by the things that are honest in the sight of all men. Again, this is teaching against retaliation, and this is the kind of thing the way a lot of people want to be today. If somebody's wrong, they want to get them back, you know. And I guess at some point in time we've been there too. But teaching against that. Philippians 4 or 5 tells us here, let your moderation or godly principles be known to all men. Both be gentle, forbearing one another, and be reasonable about things. We're showing meekness to all. Not that we're just that people run over, but we're showing meekness to all men. Be gentle, forbearing, reasonable. Again, we're admonished to serve, do good unto all men, especially those when they have faith, says in Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. We need to do good to all men, especially those with the house of faith. This is something that the child of God should have a desire to do, and something that we shouldn't have to be told over and over, you know, to do. We should have a desire to please God after all. You know, he sent his son to die such a horrible death and have a life everlasting. The least we can do is try to please him. If a person, a believer, don't have the desire to serve and please the Lord, he's out of fellowship or not saved one. And two, serving, we need to serve out of love, not out of duty. There's a lot of things that we're taught it's our duty as a child of God. We need to serve out of love, not just because it's our duty to do so. Here, verse 3, Paul writes, "Fend men to each other, wise, sent not to boast of water, believe in the word of our Lord Jesus Christ, to the doctrine which is according to God, and she is proud, knowing nothing, and doing about questions, describes the words. Word come in, which drives great evil from us, hurt, disputes, men, corrupt minds, destitute of the truth, and spoke against God, and such was Paul himself." Paul's right here and teaches only of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not other ways of salvation. There's no other way to be saved except by Jesus Christ. The things the church should teach to be called the house of God, supernatural creation, doctrine of the fall of man, human depravity, punishment for sins, salvation of grace, repentance. He speaks a wholesome word there in that verse 3, it's helpful or spiritual words and sound doctrine. If we think spiritually, it produces a healthy body. We trust in God to forgive completely when we pray and ask him forgiveness. Trust that he's going to do what he says he'll do. And we need to do what we, it's our duty to do, and do it out of love. We're told in, I think the Titus chapter 2, verse 1 and 2, the sound doctrine will produce sound life. Some are not the fear of things, but hold the sound of words of pain. It's going to turn to Titus chapter 2, verse 1. I speak out the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged men be sober, grave, and sound in faith, charity, and patience. Verse 7, and all things showing us have a pattern of good work and doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, and sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no anything to say here. So we want to have a sound life. We need to have a sound doctrine. We need to be sound in the doctrine of the Lord. Verse 3 here is talking about wholesome words and sound doctrine. This is the teaching of Christ, is an example of the Christ words that they're talking about here. Mark chapter 13, verse 31, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words will not pass away. These things that we can depend on, being sober, these are the words of Christ. Luke 4:22, they all bearing witness there and wondered at the gracious words that proceeded out of his mouth. He was kind, compassionate, and polite. He did get it rough on those Pharisees and scribes. He told them exactly what they were. He didn't mess around about that, but he was kind, compassionate, polite. His words were mighty. People were astonished at his words in Luke chapter 4, verse 32, where his words were the power. He had the power to calm the wind and the sea. Spiritual. It's the spirit's equipment. Flesh problem, nothing. The words that I speak to you, they're spirits and they're life. Words of life giving, John 6, 66 and 67, where I said many disciples went back and walked in no more with him. And Jesus asked the 12, will you also go away? And Peter answered him and said, Lord, whom shall we go? Now is the word of life. Nobody could compare the word to compare with the Lord. John 7:46 says, never a man spake like this man. No words by any man be compared with what Christ spoke. Amen. He spoke words of judgment. He said, he that rejected me, which is not my words, I one that judges him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. His words were divine. The word that he spoke was from the Father. So he that loved me not, keep not my saying, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father which sent me. So these are some sound words that Christ spoke that we can sink our teeth into, some might say. If we want to have a sound life, then we need to follow Christ, his sound words. Paul speaks of the doctrine which is according to God in his third verse 3 of our text. Somebody might say, well, what is godliness? We know what godliness is. It's godlikeness. But some think that godliness is gained by things that they have. But here in verse 5 of this same text, it says, supposedly gain is godliness. Some of these people he's talking about that are teaching otherwise and know nothing. It says, supposing that gain is godliness, from such with God I say. Well, Some think it's easy going, let me alone, I'll leave you alone. Attitude, this is something that people ain't work for salvation, you know, gain salvation by God. Lost people can't live with God. Not going to gain salvation by living God. I said a while ago, Jesus wasn't easy. In Matthew chapter 23, verse 5, he says, the scribes and Pharisees, all those works they do to be seen of man. Verse 14, he called them hypocrites. He called them fools. Verse 17. Verse 24, he said, you blind guys were strained in a gnat and swallowed a camel. Verse 28, you appear outwardly righteous to men, but then you're full of hypocrisy and iniquity. He called them serpents, vipers. He didn't mess around. He told it like it was. We should be like Christ. Tell people like it is. We don't want to be rude or run people off by the way we try to tell them about the Lord. But we then need to be Christ-like and tell them how it is. You know? If we just hang all around, they're not going to do anything. They're not going to be saved if we don't tell them. Anyway, Jesus didn't compromise these people, and we shouldn't compromise either. Stick to the Word, and the truth of the Word, and the sound doctrine. Too many people out there that's telling people wrong. They're leading them on a path to hell by what they're doing, and we don't want to be doing that. We need to tell them the truth. The Bible tells us that godliness is profitable, and we know that. Psalm 37:25, David said, I've been young and now I'm old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, or his seed begging bread. God's going to take care of his people. Good men's steps are ordered by the Lord. A righteous man's steps are made necessarily a good man. Righteous men's steps are ordered by the Lord. I mean, saved and walking uprightly before God. God guides the righteous man. He may fall, but he's not going to take down the water and hold it with his hand. We have divine favor of God. Son of God. In Mark chapter 10, verse 29 and 30, read here where God promised to take care of his children. It says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things, the blessings, shall be added to you. So godliness is proper. Our lives don't end at death, those that are saved, so our works will follow. Whether good or bad. So godliness is profitable in this life and in the life to come. Receive the blessings in this life of being godly and rewards in the future life. In verse 4 of our lesson, 1 and verse 3, he's talking about teaches otherwise, which is a false teacher, other than Christ's doctrine will corrupt minds of people. And that's what's happening in a lot of churches today. People are teaching the wrong thing, corrupting the minds of people. People will fall for anything. Anyway, he's talking about these people being proud, knowing nothing, doting about questions and strife of words. 2 Timothy 2:23 says, foolish and unlearned questions, avoid. That word doting, there's a Greek word for that, I don't know how to pronounce it, but it means one that is sick or weak spiritually or foolish, and one that just is unsound in doctrine, and there's a craving to argue about something in the Bible. kind of people. I thought I got it wrong. Hit me one time, he got so mad at work, we talked about sin, and he was Pentecostal, he didn't sin. I said, "You're a sinner just like I am." And, oh, he got mad.
Did he talk in unknown tongues?
No. He sure did turn red, though. There's a lot of people, you know, that I say a lot of people. Some people bring up some question that it's not going to benefit you anyway by getting in an argument with it, so why bother? Go on. Talk about something that will do some good. The Bible tells us, there is none our questions of boys. Don't get mixed up with all that. This thing where it says tribes of words, and there's a Greek word for that, meaning macho or a fighter of words. Somebody that will get railed and insulted, troublemakers. They don't have any love for the fellow man. Totally in James chapter 4. Said, resist the proud, give grace to the humble. He does resist the proud, give grace to the humble. We don't need to be boasters of what we know. Walk the talk. We can say anything, but if we're not walking, walking, or talking, then it's not going to help anyway. Keep in mind. I got about 15 to 8. I'm going to quit right there. We'll pick up next week and say a little more about all this. The rest is in chapter here. Since I'm going to do this again, we'll stop right there and continue on next week. Appreciate y'all coming. I probably got y'all confused and stuff. I'm stammering and rambling around here. But y'all can read that and study for yourself. A lot in there. Somebody just can't beat it out. I'd really yours. Take one further. Make a sermon out of it. Good. I appreciate y'all coming and be patient listening there and something.